I would like to thank Baylor University for inviting me, and in a special, I would like to thank David Babington for inviting me for this conference. It's really a great honor to be with you all today. So today, let's speak about Peru. Many Peruvians, for the first time, became conscious of the presence of evangelicals in their society during the political campaign of Alberto Fujimori in 1990. In this paper, following the Latin American news, I shall apply the term evangelical to all Christians who are not Catholic. At the time, evangelicals represented around 5% of the population, but many of them publicly and enthusiastically supported Brother Fujimori and his promise of sweeping changes. This enthusiasm was hiding a great deal of improvisation, like most of the Fujimori's political planning in 1990. Since 1990, evangelicals have become part of the political landscape. Several renowned pastors have consistently developed public and political strategies, mainly to promote an agenda of ethics in which sexual morality plays an important role. Pastors or ex-pastors are by now spread across in the whole political spectrum. This situation confronts us with many challenging questions. I shall focus in this paper on two main points. What is the origin of evangelical political power? Is it vote discipline or a more subtle combination of factors? Two, the evangelical population is fragmented in a countless number of varied churches. Among them, who is involved in politics? How? Is it possible to distinguish, in spite of this apparent diversity, a common perspective? Before dealing with those topics, I shall present a brief chronology of evangelical political involvement during those 30 years. Before 1990, evangelical involvement in politics remained very discreet, related mainly to religious self-centered interests. Fujimori's campaign represented a turning point. Most evangelicals were involved in his party, Change 90. Out of the 52 evangelical congressional candidates, 50 belonged to Fujimori's party. Fujimori's second vice president candidate was a Baptist pastor. The unexpected success of the campaign raised many expectations among evangelicals. Some of their political mottos are quite revealing. Change 90, Peru Evangelist Country. Change 90, Religious Change, Fujiha Hope. Upon the election, the hope of a theocratic government soon evaporated. Fujimori quickly set them aside. After the self-coup of 1992, only a few of them were elected anew. 2010 represents another turning point in the history of the evangelical involvement in politics. From 1990 onwards, the evangelical population was growing at a very quick pace, doubling in 14 years and representing then a significant minority. However, from an official and legal point of view, every evangelical had no recognized space in the nation. Following Fujimori's self-coup, evangelical candidates for Congress have been spreading in most of the political parties. However, up until 2010, each evangelical candidate included in his campaign planning the project of a religious law. Evangelical leaders did not agree on all the objectives. Some, especially those who belong to more liberal trends, were advocating for a full-fledged laical state. But most of them expected to achieve a status similar to the Catholic Church and to enjoy the same benefits. In the meantime, the Catholic hierarchy was lobbying to prevent any legal initiative from the evangelicals. The blocked situation, nourished by an ongoing public debate, lasted for 30 years. Finally, in December 2010, a status for evangelical churches was established. Evangelicals reach the desired benefits, also in a minor proportion, compared to the advantages given to the Catholic Church by the Concordat. The law put an end to the political debate. Consequently, the agreement opened the way for the development of more peaceful relations between Catholic and evangelical leaders and facilitated the formation of political alliances. To understand the logic implied in the political field, it is noteworthy that, as Levitsky pointed out, Peru has been evolving since 1990 into a democracy without institutionalized and structured parties. Following the deeply rooted Caudillo tradition, a strong charismatic man unites several relevant leaders who in turn gather people from their respective bases. Such parties may not survive at best beyond a few electoral successes. Consequently, politicians do not feel any loyalty to their so-called party and move quite frequently from one to another, looking for the political platform that would guarantee them more exposure. The behavior of evangelical leaders turned politicians follows the same pattern. From 2010 onwards, evangelicals intended to develop an image of ethical leaders. They were responding on the one hand to the public preoccupation with a high level of corruption unveiled after the collapse of the Fujimori's regime, as well as to the growing pressure from liberal groups promoting an abortion protocol and egalitarian marriage. It's worth noting an ever-growing importance given to the moral agenda. Additionally, for the first time in 2016, a few evangelical pastors became some of the most influential leaders in the formation of the movement Don't Mess With My Children, in which evangelicals have massively participated. Among the most outspoken and visible leaders, it is worth mentioning pastor and congressman Julius Rosas, and his son Christian. His son was studied at Liberty University. Although presented under a different name, this movement is present in the whole of Latin America and has represented a renewed will for evangelicals and religious people to get involved in government decisions by putting pressure. The official purpose of the movement is the promotion of a moral agenda to prevent the expansion of the so-called gender ideology and to protect families and life. In 2017, the movement succeeded in gathering 1 million people in a demonstration, putting such pressure on the government that the education minister resigned and contributing to the impeachment against President Pablo Kuczynski. Now, what is the origin of evangelical political power? Political analysts conclude that there is no discipline of vote among evangelicals. Even during the much publicized landslide in Fujimori's election, some scholars suggest that many evangelicals did not support Fujimori. In later elections, the lack of consistent political backup becomes even more obvious. The congressional candidate, Alda Lasso, represents an emblematic case of the situation. In 2006, Lasso, the head pastor, wife of the megachurch Agua Viva, was elected for Congress. In 2011, she did not promote her candidacy outside her church. Lasso felt secure that no matter what, the church, 100,000 members, so they said, would get her into office. However, although she would have needed only 30,000 votes to reach her goal, she lost. As a matter of fact, evangelicals as a collective are underrepresented in Congress. Their share of congressional seats has always been lower than their share of the Peruvian population. Only one evangelical congressman out of 130 we have now in Congress. Peru is thus very far from the well-organized evangelical congressional group in Brazil. Now, if Brazils do not necessarily vote for Brazils, then why would politicians look for the support of evangelical pastors? One hypothesis is to consider the courting of evangelicals as a process of representation and recognition similar to that of other collectives, women, young professional workers, etc. This logic probably partially explains the situation. However, as we have argued in other texts, the role of evangelical pastors in politics should be understood as an element of the broader field of religion and politics. In Peru, scandals in general, and abuse scandals in particular, have not tarnished the religious institution's reputation. In a surrounding of deliquescent and despised political institutions, religious institutions stand as by far the most prestigious. Churches still enjoy over 50% of popularity, based on their ethic reputation and their much-valued social projects. Meanwhile, Congress and political parties do not reach a double digit. Since, at least before the COVID-19 crisis, the main preoccupation of the population is corruption, and since religious people are considered immune to it, it is no wonder that politicians looking for legitimacy intend to appear publicly in the company of religious people, and that they include pastors promoting an ethics-centered agenda in their congressional list. In addition to the ethical dimension, in a context of instability, evangelical conservative pastors, with their strong outspoken convictions, produce an impression of firmness and direction that is seen as lacking in the political field. Apart from the much publicized evangelical involvement in elections, religious leaders are on and off courted by politicians, and especially when they are faced with a dire challenge. Now, next question. Who is involved in politics? How? Is there a common perspective? Historical Protestant churches and liberal churches represent an insignificant proportion of the population. Following the international religious agenda, they are mainly involved in social, interreligious, and ecumenical public activities. Apart from this tiny liberal minority, most churches belong to the neo-Pentecostal or Pentecostal movement or are greatly influenced by it. Many scholars consider that the evangelical stance on politics and public affairs has greatly evolved in the past decades, and that most evangelical pastors have radically changed their shunning perspective on the so-called world, understood in the evangelist John sense. From a sociological point of view, evangelicals have grown out of a small countercultural minority to a significant proportion of the population, which makes their positions more visible and worth listening to. However, to account for the changes, specialists tend to stress the importance of the evolution of the Pentecostal movement with its successive waves, which implies a rupture in theological convictions from a pre-millennial perspective to a post-millennial one. Pentecostal pastors at first lived in the horizon of imminent eschatology, intending to save as many arms as possible. With the second Pentecostal wave and the expansion of new conceptions related to the prosperity theology and positive confession, authors state that Pentecostals have changed their attitude towards the world, getting involved in social and public matters and aspiring to improve their life conditions. No doubt, seeing these changes are noteworthy. Churches' norms on politics differ greatly. However, we have to take that into account. On the one hand, for some churches, and especially neo-Pentecostal, independent, and apostolic churches, involvement in politics is considered as a logical and dutiful prolongation of their function. 10 or 15 years ago, political involvement relied on scattered initiatives. Nowadays, this perspective has become more structured. Through conferences at the international level, many church leaders relate to each other in networks and work to coordinate a program to promote the formation of evangelical political leaders. On the other hand, many churches that are international traditional institutions, especially those closer to the initial Pentecostal or evangelical, in this case, in the North American sense, perspective, still officially maintain a distance from politics. Pastor Julio Rosas, the main mastermind behind the demonstration, was forced to leave sotto voce his pastoral work in the Christian and Missionary Alliance. But he was immediately welcomed in triumph in the independent neo-Pentecostal church Camino de Vida. On the other hand, although the imminence of the apocalypse is not predicated, the eschatological horizon remains very pregnant. Besides occasional references in speeches, it can be observed publicly in the way evangelical leaders deal with Israel and with ecological matters, among many others. The unconditional support evangelicals give to the state of Israel materializes not only in diverse statements, pressure on the Peruvian government, and rituals with the Israeli flag, but also in money collections. In reference to ecological disasters, such as Amazonian fires, that are partly the consequence of the global warming, evangelicals show a skeptic lack of interest, and some of the pastors consider the events clear signs of the pending end of the world. Although human beings are not to destroy the creation, they are meant to interpret events in a biblical perspective and to foster and guide the evolution of those events in the eschatological direction. In other words, there is no point of worrying about ecological disasters. Ultimately, worldly situations have been thought of and acted upon to promote God's designs, and those disasters are part of them. Briefly, I would like to stress a few concluding reflections. No doubt, evangelical involvement in public affairs, scope, and visibility. However, their power does not transit through usual political channels, but rather it comes through the need for legitimacy that politicians seek to obtain from them. If ethical matters have always been part of the evangelical program, after the promulgation of their legal status, the moral agenda has come to the forefront, responding as well to new national and international circumstances. The eschatological horizon that dominates the evangelical worldview plays an essential role in their decisions. More research is needed to understand the articulation between interpretation of the Bible, eschatological perspectives, and the skepticism towards empirical scientific results.